If you would, turn to the Gospel of Luke as we study through this Gospel verse by verse. We're in Luke. We start chapter 5 today. The Gospel of Luke, chapter 5. I'll be reading verses 1 through 11. You that are listening by way of the internet, get a Bible out and turn there. The Gospel of Luke, chapter 5, verse 1 through 11. And it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret and saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen were gone out of them and were washing their nets. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. And when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, Launch out into the deep, and let down your nets for a draught. And Simon answering said unto him, Master, we have toiled all the night, and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word I will let down the net. And when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net brake. And they beckoned unto their partners, which were in the other ship, that they should come and help them. And they came and filled both ships, so that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. For he was astonished, and all that were with him, at the draught of the fishes which they had taken. And so was also James and John, the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. And Jesus said unto Simon, Fear not, from henceforth thou shalt catch men. And when they had brought their ships to land, they forsook all and followed him. Would you bow with me for a word of prayer, please? Father, I come to you and I thank you and praise you for all that you are and all that you do. I thank you for the Word of God that we have preserved. Oh, these 400 years in the English language. Oh, what a blessing that we have what we know is your Word, and we thank you for it. I pray that you would continue to bless that as we try to be the salt of the earth and the light of this world, that the light of the Word of God would be shining in our hearts, that we'd hold forth this great book, and it would be on our lips and in our mannerisms, in the way that we treat people, all that kind of thing. Please, Lord, may it be such that we reflect the Lord Jesus in all that we do. Lord, I come before you. You know the needs that people have, and I ask that you'd bless Samantha. Just take care for her with this trauma that she's gone through, and bless the family as they try to help her. Lord, bless Dave as he deals with this individual caught up in the sin of homosexuality. Lord, there's a lot of other sins that people are caught up in, and they're just as bad. And I know that every sin put Jesus to the cross. Every sin drove a nail into his hands and thorns into his brow and the lash against his back, that he'd shed his blood to pay for sin. And so we just thank you for what he's done. I pray that you might uplift us and use this message. And Lord, I can't deliver it without the power of the Holy Spirit. And so I ask that you would anoint me as those prophets of old, not for my sake. Lord, I'd be a fool for thee. But I know that these people have gathered to hear from heaven. And so please, would you work in such a way that they'd go from here knowing that they've been in the presence of God Almighty. And we'll thank you for all you do in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. As we move along in this Gospel of Luke, we understand that Jesus is still in the area of Galilee. And starting in chapter 5, we see that the people came to him, and he stood by the lake Gennesaret, as what the Word of God says. The lake Gennesaret is also the Sea of Galilee. It's got a lot of different names for it. It's interesting that rabbis of old said, God made seven seas, but chose the Sea of Galilee for his blessings. And it's quite the place, quite a lovely, beautiful place. Things that I've read about it and pictures that I've seen of it, you know, quite beautiful, the Sea of Galilee. It's got some areas of it that are just as blue and just as pure. They say you can just reach down and drink it. And then, of course, there's some other areas where there's some hot springs that come into it that are, you know, medicinal and that kind of thing. And so I've never been there, but I imagine that someday, you know, we'll be able to see. But anytime you're by the ocean, or not the ocean, but the water's edge, you know, there's a natural amphitheater kind of effect that takes place. You know, people out on a boat, oftentimes, you know, they're just talking normal to each other, and it sounds like they're shouting right at your ear. You can hear them offshore, and, you know, it's quite amazing how the water reflects the voice and that kind of thing. So this is where Jesus has come. The people have come, and, of course, we know that there's villages there, so with the people coming, the villages would provide water and some food and that kind of thing for them. So they've come to hear Jesus. That's what verse 1 talks about there. They've come to hear what Jesus had to say. They wanted to learn from Jesus. We all do. I hope that you do. We all want to hear from Jesus and how important that is. But there's a lesson in these 11 verses. And the lesson that I believe God would want us to learn is revolves around our faith. How does your faith react? That's the kind of picture that I have here. How do we react in our faith? How does it work? And we've got to act and react on the very words of God. And I hope when you leave today, that's what will be in your mind, that I need to act upon the very words of God. That's important. And these verses will encourage us in our faith today. A.W. Tozer said this about faith, and he said it this way: faith, as Paul saw it, was a living, flaming thing leading to surrender and obedience to the commandments of Christ. Yeah, we ought to have faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. I want to please God. I got to have faith. Got to have a lot of faith. Have to walk in faith, live in faith, move in faith, you know, do everything by faith. It's important for us. Well, I look at verses 1 through 3, first of all, this morning, as faith with the message. Faith with the message, verses 1 through 3. The people came to hear the word of God. That's what verse 1 tells us here. They didn't come to be entertained. And a lot of people go to church anymore, and they want to be entertained. Did you feel good after you left church? You know, did you get a blessing? Well, you should, but, you know, they're asking more of, you know, how well did your flesh get worked up? That ought not to be what it is. They came and they pressed upon him, it says here, to hear the word of God. And that's an important thing for us. And, of course, it says in verse 2, and saw two ships standing by the lake. We're talking about, you know, what the Lord Jesus saw. There were two ships there, but the fishermen were gone out of them and were washing their nets. Now, we know, because we've read through the entire passage here, that they were washing their nets because they'd toiled all night, caught nothing. You know, all they got were seaweed, and that was it. You know, maybe some mud from the bottom of the lake, but they caught nothing at all. And these fishermen, Peter, Andrew, James, and John, you know, they had been called to follow the Lord earlier. But I believe they went back fishing. You know, in John chapter 1, they were called. But in John chapter 21, remember there at verse number 3, if you want to take a look, you can. But after Jesus was crucified and buried, you know, they got really despondent about things. They were really quite upset about it. And I don't know why my fingers keep wanting to go to Acts chapter 21. But John chapter 21, verse 3, It says there, Simon Peter saith unto them, I go a fishing. They say unto him, We also go with thee. Then they went forth and entered into a ship immediately, and that night they caught nothing. You know, so this wasn't a new thing here in John chapter 21. Apparently Peter did that before. He decided, well, I'll go fishing. This is my profession. This is my job. This is what I'm all about here, is that I'm a fisherman. And these men, you know, had gone back to fishing. Here they are washing their nets. They had to clean them and repair them, get them ready for the next time they were going to use them. So Jesus here in verse number 3, it says, and he entered into one of the ships. He just got into the ship, you know. And it was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down, taught the people out of the ship. He just got into the ship. And the question that came to my mind is, well, how do we react when God wants us to use our possessions for him? You know, something that we own. Jesus says, I want to use it. I want it for this or that. I want to use it. Now, how do we react to that kind of a thing? His ship was his livelihood. What if Jesus had taken it out and sunk the thing? Well, there'd gone his livelihood. You know, how do we react to what things we possess when God says, I want to use those things? And he told him to thrust out a little. So there he was on the shore after toiling all night. And he says to him, okay, put the boat out a little bit. Thrust it out a little bit. You know, whatever you have to do. I can't imagine this thing being a rowboat. I imagine it bigger because it says ship. You know the difference between a boat and a ship. You can put a boat on a ship, but you can't put a ship on a boat. That's the difference. Amen? So, it's a ship. So, you know, to get the thing out through the waves, whatever, and get it out there a little bit. I asked the question, well, how do you react when God wants you to give up some of your pleasures? You know, how do you react to that? You know, what goes through your head? Oh, man, I'm so tired. I toiled all night. Oh, I'm so tired. You know, God does ask us that sometimes. You know, I got this ache. I got that pain. I'm hurting here. God says, no, I want you to do this. Yeah. How do you react to all that? How does your faith come in? You know, they toiled all night. Now they're working to clean the nets and get them ready for the next time they're going to use them. And he says, launch out a little bit into the deep. And he sat down and taught the people. Now we're not told what he taught them here. Luke doesn't record for us what the message was, what he said to them. You know, we don't know here what he said, but he did teach them. The words aren't given, but he also teaches a lesson. Now, Peter heard firsthand. He's in the boat. I don't know what Peter looked like. You know, sometimes when a pastor has an evangelist come in or whatever. I've been in some churches where the pastor, and I wasn't the pastor, I was visiting. You know, the pastor will stay sitting up there while the evangelist preaches. So he's turned his pulpit over to somebody else, and the other man's preaching along, and the pastor's sitting there. And you watch the pastor, and he's, you know, that's not a good thing, you know. I wonder what Peter looked like in the back of the boat. Oh, I've worked all night, you know. He's preaching on and on. You know, I just want to go lay down. You know, I wonder what he looked like in the back of the boat. Yeah, maybe he hung on every word. I don't know. Maybe. But the real message for him was coming. Jesus gave a message. By the way, we knew some missionaries to Micronesia and all those little islands, and they had to use a ship, and this was the verse that he used. He sat down and taught the people out of the ship. And that was his house. He had to buy a sailing vessel that would handle the ocean and raise the money for that. And that was their house. You know, that's where he and the kids and wife lived in that, and they'd go from one island to next island, the next island, keep going around and around. He was a missionary to Micronesia, taught them out of the ship. But I see, secondly, this morning, faith with the Master, verses 4 through 7. Faith with the Master, verse 4 through 7. We start there in verse 4. Now it says, "Now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a draught." He asks him to go to the deep. You know, sometimes God asks us to go to the deep. And you know, we start out where we thrust out a little from the land, verse 3. You know, maybe it's prayer. And, you know, we just pray, and we pray this a little bit and that a little bit and that kind of thing. But sometimes God asks us to launch out into the deep and pray all night. You know, pray for something earnestly. Maybe it's in our witness where, you know, God tells us to go out it's one thing to just hand out a tract. You know, you can just kind of, here, would you read this? That's pretty easy to do. But, you know, actually stand there and witness to somebody and tell them more than, you know, this tract gets you to heaven. You know, you're a sinner. You need Jesus as your Savior. You know, go out into the deep a little bit more. You know, go out to where some people maybe aren't as friendly. Or go out into the deep where they don't speak the same language. You know, that's why now I carry Spanish tracts. You know, it's terrible. You hand them the Spanish tract and they say something to you in Spanish. And they, okay, that was as far as I could go. I'm farther than shore. I'm over my head now, you know. But God tells us sometimes, launch out into the deep. You know, you never know what kind of thing it might be. In our Christian walk, we need to walk out farther than just a little from the land. You know, I think of that little from the land. Well, okay, I got saved, and that was my past life, and I'll just walk just a little from it. But he says, no, walk out in the deep. Get far away from it. You know, we need to do that sometimes. Just get away from it. And it's important for us to do that. And he told him, let down your nets. How do you react to God's orders? When God says to do something, how do you react? I mean, if right now in the message, not me, not anything about me, but let's just say you looked down at a verse or you looked across the page at a verse and that verse really smote your heart and the Holy Spirit told you, get down on your knees up at the front of the church right now. You know, how would you react to that? You know, you'd say, what? Everybody'd see me. But God told you to do it. How do you react? Well, by faith, you should react the right way. Say, okay, God's the master. He said to do it. I'll go do it. You know, maybe some other people get down on their knees too. You never know. Well, how do you react when God says to do something? God says, tell that person to give him a track. Go give him a track. No, I got to get over here. Go give him a track. Lord, you know, I'm busy. My time. Go give him a track. You know, how do you react when God gives you an order? Yeah. He's the master. And I can imagine going through Peter's head, this guy's a carpenter and he's telling me about fishing? How can that be? And what does he know about fishing? You know, he didn't know anything. I'm a professional fisherman here. I do this for a living. He's not fishing with a hook and a worm. He's not an amateur. He's a professional. He's using a net. He's trying to get a lot of fish for his, this is his livelihood, right? You know, and the carpenter's going to tell me. Hey, when we were building a church, there were a lot of times that, you know, the people on the building committee, you know, that were carpenters and masons and electricians and all that kind of thing. What's the pastor know about this? What does he know about this? Well, God just kind of tells me some things sometimes, you know. God tells me what things will work and won't work. Can't we do this way? Wouldn't this work out? Wouldn't this be a help? Oh, we never thought of that. Yeah, isn't that something? God did. Amen. Let me in on it. So, you know, it just, how do you react? God's orders in your life. Peter's first reaction was to argue with the Lord, Verse 5, I know that because it says, nevertheless. You know, in other words, well, if you really insist, the first thing out of his mouth really is, no, Lord, no, 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 no. We toiled all the night. We professionals toiled all the night and have taken nothing. The fish are not here. Now, that's the first thing out of his mouth. Sometimes for us, the first thing out of our mouth, no. Go to say something to somebody, you know, try to help them out. And I've even seen this where, you know, a mother was trying to help the daughter with next time. You know, the next time you go to do this, do it this way. And the daughter, right away, the daughter, no, 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 you know, because she thought it was for this time. This time's already passed. It's too late now. All the damage is done. But next time, but no, right away they want to say no. Yeah. We ought to listen. God gave us two ears and one mouth. We ought to listen twice as much as we speak. So we ought to do. And he argued, how about you? You know, is that your way with God? Is that how your faith plays out, to argue with God? No. But then it says here, nevertheless. Nevertheless tells me also, not only did he argue with God, but that he had a partial obedience. You know, he's doing it on the outside, but not on the inside. You know how little Johnny got sent to the corner, time out, in the corner, Johnny. I'm standing in the corner on the outside, but in the inside, I'm still out there playing. Yeah. Is that how our faith works? Only a partial faith? Yeah. Okay, nevertheless, you know what? Okay, I'll do it. You know, I've seen you do some big things, so I'll do it. He thought it was futile, but nevertheless, at thy word. Can you imagine if he really realized this was Almighty God at thy word? I mean, at the word of God, the whole of creation was made. At the word of God, every star that's out there was put in place. At the word of God, every animal was created, above the sea, below the sea, in the air, at the word of God. At thy word. Wow. You know, that's what we ought to say. Okay, Lord, your word says it. That's how my faith ought to be. The word of God said it. I'm going to do it. Nevertheless, at thy word. And then you notice that it says there, verse 6, and when they, do you notice the word they, that little word they, just four letters right there, T-H-E-Y, they. Who's the they? Simon and Jesus. That's all that's in the boat. When Jesus helps you do something, great things happen. When he's the one in charge, oh boy, what great results. And when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes and their net break. Wow, that had to be something. There's the Apostle Peter. With little faith, with a token, nevertheless, at thy word I will let down the net. Okay, I'll go ahead and do it. But the faith of the Son of God. You know, you ought to study that out sometime. I'm still meditating on that. One day I'll bring a message on the faith of the Son of God. That's what the Word of God says in places. The faith of the Son of God working in my life. My faith's very limited. My faith can be very small. My faith can be faulty. My faith can be half-hearted. But the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ is perfect every single time. Is it no wonder that the Father said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased"? Because his faith was perfect, and without faith it's impossible to please God. I like it when Jesus is holding on to the net with me. It's a good place to be. That's a very good place to be. Now, said the net break. This was a thought that I read this week that I was kind of surprised about. You know, this is before the cross. And so some got away. If you compare this with what goes on there in John chapter 21, and we're not going to do that this morning, that's after the cross and none of them get away. The net doesn't break. in John chapter 21. Kind of an interesting comparison to think about. But let me move on here to verse 7. It says, "And they beckoned unto their partners, which were in the other ship, and that they should come and help them." I ask this question: how do you react to sharing your blessings? God's blessed you with this and this and this. How do you react with sharing that? I've got two vines of grapes, two stalks come up, and they make a little grape thing there, and we get enough grapes out of it to make a couple little pints of grape juice. My neighbor says, how about those grapes? You going to do anything with those grapes? I want to make wine. I said, nope. Yeah. But I'd be willing to share some grape juice with them. We've got a couple blueberry bushes, and we share those with the Hardmans. Whenever they come, the blueberries are in season. We always give them some of the blueberries. But God asks us a lot of times to share our blessings. You know, how do we react to that? What kind of, really, Lord? I mean, I've worked so hard for that, and I really want that, and now you want me to share that? You know, your success. How do you do with sharing that? So they beckoned, and the Word of God tells us here in verse 7, and they came and filled both the ships so that they began to sink. I want you to understand, first of all, Jesus knows when and where to fish. My wife and I were privileged to have a guide in our church out in Michigan. I'd call him up and say, "Hey, this is my day off. How can I come over and fish?" He'd say, "No, don't even bother. Fish aren't even going to bite. You know, that's not the right day. Don't come over." So I said, "What, you know, let me go fishing. I just want to go fish. Go sit in the boat and fish." "Nope, ain't going to do any good. You know, it's not catching, it's fishing. You know, nope, I ain't going to let you drown the worms today. Another day, we have a chance, but today, no chance." You know, Jesus knows where and when to fish. Amen? And the second thing, we need to obey Him because He knows. Now, we don't always know, but He knows. That's important for us. Well, let me go on to a third thing this morning. A third part of the verse is here to encourage us in our faith. Faith with the mission. Faith with the mission, verse 8 through 11. We start there at verse 8. When Simon Peter saw it, he realized that he was dealing with God here. When you and I see how great and holy God is, we see how sinful we are. It's what he said here. He fell down on his knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O God." I was reminded by my son many times to help people come to know Jesus as Savior. Instead of pointing out how sinful they are, we need to point out how holy God is and that we just don't measure up. We come short of the glory of God. He is absolutely the holy, holy, holy God. Yeah. And that's what Peter saw here, now that Jesus was God. And when he saw God, he said he was sinful. When Isaiah saw God, he realized he was sinful. Yeah. We're dealing with a God who's absolutely perfectly sinful. And if it wasn't for the perfect righteousness of Jesus Christ given to us, not a one of us could stand before Him. Not a one of us could. He was sinful. Before this, Peter thought he was a fisherman. But he'd toiled and he'd failed. Now he knows that his own strength let him down. Following Jesus proved to be a success for him. And you and I need to understand that. Yeah, we might be good at this or that, the other thing, and we may have done it many, many times, but I'm telling you, if it isn't God doing it through us, it's not going to be a success. It really is not. Never will be. This miracle impacted others also. We notice there, it says in verse 10, and so was also James and John, the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. And, you know, they were astonished. Verse 9 tells us they were astonished with him. They had toiled with him too. And now there's so much that the ships began to sink. That's a lot of weight inside of a boat. You know, to make that ship want to sink, that's a lot of fish. And so the miracle impacted others. You know, so when God does some things in your life, when you react by faith, when you take God at His word, you know, it can impact others' lives. You just don't know what's going on, how many people are watching you as to what things are happening in your life. And so this is what happened to them. Now, I want you to understand that Jesus did not come to fill boats with fish. That wasn't why He came to earth, go around filling boats with fish. He came to fill heaven with men and women and boys and girls. And that's what the message is all about. So at the end of verse 10, and Jesus said unto Simon, "Fear not, from henceforth thou shalt catch men." That's a whole lot better. And by the way, this "fear not" takes faith. Just like letting down the net took faith, "fear not" takes faith. For us to go out and try to win people to Jesus Christ, for us to be fishers of men, takes some faith. And we've got to carry this "fear not," because if we look at the faces of men and women, it'll frighten us. It'll turn us from giving out the gospel. But we need to go out there and fear not and pass that track. Say the word. Live the life that people will see. By the way, why catch fish when you can catch men? Verse 11, and when they had brought their ships to land, they forsook all and followed Him. Why not? No job's worth a soul. No house is worth a soul. No car is worth a soul. No boat, as in this case, is worth a soul. They forgot, they forsook all. Left it all there for the father of Zebedee there. They were the sons of Zebedee. They just left it all. Okay, He called us before. We went back fishing. Maybe by faith we ought to walk this way. At Thy word, we'll be fishers of men. Let me conclude. A good fisherman knows the right time, the right bait, and the right touch. Yeah. A good soul winner knows the right time, the right way to bring them to Jesus Christ, the right touch. Like Dave, you were saying earlier about that man on the internet, you have to go gentle and help him understand sin is sin. Doesn't matter what it is. A lie is just as bad as any other sin. Yeah. But I also want you to know, as I conclude here, there's another fisherman, Satan. He's trying to hook people. His bait's false bait. But he's out there. He's trying to catch as many as he can. And instead of them being in heaven forever with the Lord Jesus Christ, they'll be in hell and damnation. And he uses lies for his bait. And he's a good fisherman. He catches a lot. His lies bring so many. But you and I need to be fishers of men. At Thy word, Lord, I will believe. At Thy word, Lord, whatever it takes. It's my possessions, if it's my pleasures, at Thy word, I'll obey Thy orders. Is it my success and my blessings, Lord? Whatever it is, by faith I'm willing to give those for the lives of men. I want to catch men. I don't know about you folks. I want to catch men. I've caught a lot of fish, not near as thrilling as being there when some man or woman, boy or girl asked Jesus to be Savior. Amen. What a great thing. What a great thing. At Thy word, would you just have the faith to trust him. Let's bow together. So we have our heads bowed and our eyes closed. I don't know, God might be asking you for your boat, your nets, your time, your blessings. I don't know. It's not for me to know. It's for what God wants to do in your life. What I do know is what he's asking you, you have to react to it by faith. And if you do, there'll be men and women, boys and girls, come to Jesus as Savior. We have to realize and understand Jesus is the Master. And his message and his mission is to tell people about Jesus Christ. And we're his ambassadors. And we need to do that. You that are tuning in by way of the internet, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, today could be that day. Today, if you'll just admit before God you're a sinner, that you do these things that the Bible says are sin, they're wrong, they make you absolutely unworthy of heaven, that you really deserve hell. But God provided a way through Jesus Christ when he sent him to die on the cross and to be buried and to rise again the third day according to the scriptures for your sins. You can be washed in that blood. If you'll just cry out to Jesus and beg him to save you. Believe by faith that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. It's not going to happen if you just sit there. You need to do something about it. Get on your knees and pray and tell God you're sorry for your sin, you're turning from it, and that you're asking Jesus to be Savior and Lord of your life. Let him come in and rule your life and give you eternal life. You that are here, whatever God's speaking to you, would you respond to it? Father, I come to you and I thank you once again that you're a God that works and moves in mysterious ways. And Lord, I want to be there with you, with your hands on the net and mine on the net, and we'll bring in many men and women to Jesus Christ. You know, Lord, that that's a great desire of mine to win people to Christ, and all of us here. And so I pray that you might use us. Thank you again for your blessings. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hymn number 562, Be Thou My Vision.